Salvete omnes. Today we're talking about the second king of Rome, a guy named Numa Pompilius. Now, after the death of Romulus, there was an interregnum. An interregnum means between the kingdom or between the power. And it's the time between when there was when one ruler has stopped ruling, either passed away or given up his power, and then the new ruler has started. And it's a big concern for all governments, even today, to try to minimize the time between, to minimize the interregnum, because things can happen that are not so good for a country when there's a vacuum of power. At the death of Romulus, or his deification, depending on how you look or what you believe, the senators began quarreling over who was going to be the next king. The senators were divided into factions of mainly Romans and Sabines. Remember, the Sabines were the people who joined Rome later after their women had been abducted by the Romans. To solve the intermediate problem, they divided into 10 groups called decacures, each one elected one man as president. The 10 men ruled the city for every 5 days, rotating the powers of the king among them. So instead of having a king, they had 10 people who would rule. This is called the interregnum. People hated the interregnum because it felt like they had 100 masters. The senators went out looking for a king and told the commoners that if they had chose a successful Romulus, they would ratify the choice. The people were delighted and selected Numa Pompilius, a Sabine with a reputation for justice and piety. He was an educated and noble man. And some people even say that he was a disciple of Pythagoras, but this does not work time-wise. Now, they decided to conduct an augury to make sure that this was okay for the gods. And an augury, of course, is a bird watching, where you watch the sky and you watch the birds fly across to make sure it's going to be okay. And this is the quote from Livy. An augur whose service on the occasion was afterwards recognized by the grant of the permanent priesthood escorted Numa to the citadel, where he took his seat on a stone with his face to the south. The augur with a veiled head sat on his left, holding in his right hand the smooth, crooked-handled staff called the Lituus. Gazing out over the city and the country below, he uttered a prayer and marking with a glance the space of the sky from east to west and declaring the southward section to be right and the northward section to be left, he took an imaginary point full in front of him as far as his eyes could reach, transferred the staff to his left hand, placed his right hand upon Numa's head, and spoke these solemn words. And this is the augury to see if it was okay for Numa to become king. Father Jupiter, this is what the augur said, if it's heaven's will that this man, Numa Pompilius, whose head I touch and reign in the city of Rome, make clear to us sure signs within those limits I have determined. So he says he's looking for a sign, a flight of birds. Then he named precisely the nature of the signs he hoped would be set. Sent they were, and Numa was duly appointed king. So, and what we have here is a coin up here where they're doing an augury, and the little staff of the guy is a lintulus, I believe. And there's like a goat or something happening. All right. Now, Numa gave Rome a second beginning on a solid basis of law and religious observance. The people would not be civilized if constantly fighting wars. So he felt that Numa, this new king, felt that the Romans had become too barbaric fighting their neighbors all the time under Romulus. And so they decided to create a religious and cultural foundation for the city. The first thing he did was built the Temple of Janus, whose doors were open in time of war and closed in times of peace. And so he created the temple to mark when the Romans would be fighting or not. And only two times after Numa were they closed, when Manlius defeated the Carthaginians, the First Punic War, and then with Augustus after the Battle of Actium. So what he did is, after establishing goodwill and treaties with the neighboring peoples, Numa closed the doors of the temple. So he closed the doors and said, the Romans are done fighting for now. And then he went out and helped to establish more religious observances for the Romans. Now, he told everyone that he met with a goddess, a local deity, a nymph named Egeria at night for counsel. And she advised Numa on the best ways to worship the gods. First thing he did was divide the year into 12 lunar months and inserted intercalendary days. So a lunar month instead of a solar month doesn't quite work. There's not 12 months because the cycle of the moon is almost a month, but not quite. And so to make sure that the year balances out and you always get to the same point every year, they had to put special days between the end of 1 month and the start of the new year. And then eventually what they did is they had a certain extra month now and then to make sure the calendar works out. He also established faste dies and dies nefasti. So faste dies are lawful days and dies nefasti are unlawful days. So faste dies, the assemblies and business can happen. You can just go about your normal things. Dies nefasti are kind of like holidays where you can't do typical business days, and there could be religious things that need to be done and so forth, but you couldn't go about your normally daily business. He established the Flamen Dialis, the priest of Jupiter. He established priests of Mars and Quirinus, a local deity that some people think was Romulus. He appointed Vestal Virgins, so the priestess of Vesta. He established the 12 Salii, the leaping priests who carried the Ancilla, the sacred shields of Mars that supposedly fell down from, or there was one shield that fell down from heaven one day. And then they made copies of it, and the 12 Salii carried the sacred shields. He appointed Numa Marcius, son of Marcus, as Pontifex Maximus. So this became the chief priest of Rome. And he was in charge of all the information about Roman religion. He gave the Pontifex full written instructions for all religious observances. He consecrated on the Aventine Hill an altar to Jupiter Elechius. The population in Rome was given a great number of things to talk about, and to think about and talk about. And then what happened with all this is that Romans became so holy, spent so much time worshiping the gods and doing it properly, as they would say, that all their neighbors changed their whole opinion of them. That they never thought they thought the Romans, who were these kind of barbaric warriors, became these very holy people. And actually, no one attacked the city of Rome during Numa's reign because to do so would be sacrilegious. Eventually, of course, Numa passed away. And the grandest achievement of Numa's reign was that he remained a jealous guardian of peace, even more than power. And after the rule of 37 years, Numa after Romans ruled for 37 years, Numa ruled for 43. When Numa died, Roman, by the twin disciples of peace and war, was as eminent for self-mastery as for military power. And there we go. So this is the second king of Rome, Numa Pompilius. Just think about him as being a very religious, holy man who established Roman religion. And there we go. Volite omnes lingua Latina est vita.